Hello, and welcome back to my Java tutorial series on how to teach you how to make a dice roller, among several other things, in the dice roller series, episode 2. Now today, as I said the last time, that today we're going to set up the infrastructure for the GUI, so we're just going to do diceroller.gui, so we can set up our own classes. Now the first thing that we're going to need is a GUI element, and this will be the parent class for everything, for all the GUI elements. And since we don't want to be able to instantiate it, and we want some abstract methods, we're going to make this an abstract class, which means you can't say, you know, GUI element G equals new GUI element, because it's abstract. The only way to get a type of GUI element is to extend it in a new class, as I explained in a previous episode of my Java tutorial series. So this class is actually going to be pretty simple. What it's going to need, if I can spell, is its bounds. This is so we can, you know, set the location and the size of the GUI element, and also for detection for when we eventually make buttons. And then we're going to have a buffered image, because there's going to be some things we want to do with some of the other GUI elements that will require a graphics object, and it doesn't matter where we get them, since it's really things that don't do anything with the graphics except just get measure fonts and stuff like that. We're just going to make it a 4-byte alpha blue green red. Actually, let's make it a 3-byte. Buffered image. Oh, okay, whatever. Doesn't matter. This doesn't matter at all, because, you know, it's just one wide and one high, and we're not going to draw it anywhere. We're just going to steal its graphics objects every now and again. So then what we need is the actual constructor, which all we need is the location of it, the width and the height, and I'm just abbreviating those W and H, even though you wouldn't normally do that. I'm just doing it here because it's just, you know, a lot easier. So instead of me typing out width and height, I can just type the letters. And just one last thing, that's our abstract method, is that we're gonna want every GUI element to be able to be drawn. And since we're going to be passing a graphics2D object to it, we might as well make it a graphics2D instead of a graphics. So that's it for the GUI element class. Pretty simple, but pretty integral. So we can just X out of that, and then make a new class. Well, actually, before we make a class, we're going to make an interface, and it's going to be iClickable. And it's just going to provide some key methods that we're going to need for any of our GUI elements that you can click, such as our buttons. So I have a public boolean, add action listener, of course you have to input action listener, then a remove action listener, and the boolean, and you know, for interfaces, as I have explained before, are just a collection of methods that are mainly used so you can call different iClickables and call the same exact method, but anything that extends iClickable can do whatever they want with the method. And then last but not least, public void click, which will be whatever this GUI element would do if and when it is clicked. Okay. Now here's our first real element we'll be doing, and this is a GUI button. And of course it's going to extend GUI element and implement iClickable. Now this is going to have to, you know, we have to add the constructor, which is simple enough, even though we're going to make it a bit more complicated. And there's a lot of methods. We'll fix those errors very quickly. It's just I have to make them look good first. This could be like that, yeah. And then draw method is where things get fun. So I'm just going to bring the draw method up over here. That's not what I wanted to do. There we go. Okay. Maybe not that close. Make those nice and snug. So before we actually do anything with the GUI button, we're just going to handle these. So we're going to have a private string command, a private array list of action listeners. Those would just be the listeners. And then that's pretty much it. So then for this, we'll just, I know I haven't instantiated listeners yet, but that's fine for now. So now we just add Ellie. Well, we return this. So that means the add method for array lists return a boolean as to whether it was added, and that's the exact same for whether they were removed or not. So we just have to do the exact same thing, but with remove. So that was easy enough. Now for this, we just do this dot command equals AC. Pretty simple. Now for the click, what we have to do is a for loop, which will be for all the action listeners in the array list listeners. We're going to say al.actionPerformed, and we're going to create our own action event to send to everyone. And what the three parameters are the origin, which is this, the button is creating the event. And then the next parameter is, we got to import action event. I can see that. And then the next parameter is the something else. But the last parameter is action event dot action perform. Now there are several different actions. Integer then a string. Now when you go into the action event and you look at all these, there's a whole bunch of different action performed, like the first action or last action, and that's just the order in which the actions would be processed. So what you this is just a normal action. So you just send the action as performed. So that just means, you know, it doesn't have any special priorities. I'm just going to do this because I forget what the last parameter is. Oh, yeah, the action command. Yeah, okay. Okay, and that's everything we need it to actually be a button. What I like to do for the GUI button, because we're going to have multiple constructors for the GUI button depending on how we want to set it up in certain scenarios. So what I like is a nice unifying method, which we'll just call init for initialization. And at the end of each constructor, we'll just say init. So the init is what every GUI button will have to do, no matter what. But first we're going to make the public string the label, so what it will say on the button. Then we'll just do some private things, such as character height, character width, and font size, private boolean is framed, then a private font, and some private colors, which will be the foreground color, background color, and text color. And one final thing, which would be a rectangle 2D, which is like a rectangle, except a bit more useful. And those will be our string bounds. So now all we have to do is just import all of these different mechanics, well, all these different classes that we're going to be using. Now for this first GUI button, the only thing you'll have to give it is the string, which will be the label, and a boolean, whether is to be framed. There. So right after this, we'll say is framed equals F, and label equals L. Also, for our font size mechanic, the font size will equal the height of the component. And then what we're going to do is say this.font equals new font, and the default font will be Arial, which is a pretty generic font. It will normally be font.plain, as opposed to bold or italicized, and the font size will be H, which we could use just font size the variable, but it'd be easier to use H since we're already in the constructor. Now we're going to add two more of these. Of course, they're going to do different things. The next thing is going to be another string, which is the font, and an integer, which is the font style. So this way, it's exactly like the previous one, except this is going to be the font, and instead of just font.plain, the font style you can customize. So very similar. And then the last one is going to be very different. We're going to get rid of the width and height entirely and replace it with another GUI button. And we can even get rid of the field. Now this is when you're just trying to make a lot of buttons which are the same size and basically the same in every aspect instead of except for what they say and where they are. So we can just easily call gb.bounds.width and gb.bounds.height. This is so they have the same width and height. Is framed will be that, and it will be gb.fontsize. And then we'll just say the font equals the past GUI button's font. So everything is the same. So those are all the constructors we're going to have, and now we can worry about the initialization, which is, you know, where we set the majority of the remaining variables, except for the colors. There will be a separate method for that. So as I said we were going to do before, we're going to grab the graphics of the buffered image that is protected in the GUI element class, and we're going to steal font metrics from it. It'll be font metrics from the font. And of course we have to import font metrics. So the first thing we're going to set is character height equals font metrics dot get ascent. Now there are three different things that have to do with the character height in the certain font, which is ascent, descent, and height. Ascent is the baseline of the character to the top of most characters. So if you think about just like the letter L, it goes from the bottom of that to the top of that. Descent is from the baseline to the bottom. So if you have a Y or a G or a J, it goes from the baseline, which is just the bottom of where, you know, the bottom of an L would normally be, or a normal letter, and down to the bottom of those letters. And height, I think, is the ascent, is, oh yeah, it's the leading plus the ascent plus the descent. And the leading of a font is the interline spacing. So it's between the, so it's just the distance between a line above it and a line below it. So we want the ascent, which is just the basic height of the character. Character width, if we were dealing with monospaced fonts like Courier New or Courier, it would be a lot easier since every character is the exact same width, but since we could be dealing with something else, we won't be using character width that much, but we're just going to want the width of a space character. So we can just add our own spaces places. And finally, well, almost finally, string bounds equals fm.getStringBounds of a string, which will be the label, and the context will be G2, since that is the graphics object we were using. And finally, we can say g2.dispose, and just to get everything out, initialize this, listeners equals new array list. And again, that's just generic types with the diamond notation that I showed in a tutorial episode. Now we get down to the fun part, which is, of course, drawing. Now what we're going to do is that, you know, if it's supposed to be framed, we'll frame it. But for the label will be centered within the bounds. So we'll just do if is framed. We'll start with that since that is easy. We'll do G2, set color. And the first color will be the foreground color, which you'll see why we do that. And we're going to fill a rectangle of bounds.x, bounds.y. Bounds.width and bounds.height. So that fills the entire bounds with it. Next, we will set the color to the background color, and we'll do a very similar thing, except it will be inset by 2 pixels on each side. So the foreground is the actual frame of it, like the box surrounding it, and the background is the color inside the box, which you'll see more when we actually do an example. Now next, we'll just set the, oh, I forgot, it's G2 object, and we'll set the color to text color, and we'll do, and we'll set the font to our font. Now for math. So the X is going to be where, when you draw strings, it's from the bottom left, and the bounds is from the upper left. So from the upper left, we have to figure out where the bottom left of the string will be. Which means, and if we want to center it, we will have to do some simple-ish math. So it'll be bounds plus X, which means we're going to move it to the right. And it's going to be bounds.width divided by 2, which means this alone will give us half of it. So if we do bounds.x plus bounds.width divided by 2, that'll give us the exact middle of this button. Then if we do string bounds dot get width divided by 2, that'll give us the we have to cast that to integer since it returns a double. That will give us, you know, half of the string bounds. So if you take the middle of it minus half of it, then that means the whole thing will be centered on the middle of it. And bounds plus X is just so, you know, we get the right position on screen. Now we do something very similar for Y, except Y is a plus instead of a minus since we're going for the bottom left and not the upper left. So this, again, will just be bounds.height divided by 2. This we have to cast to integer since it will be string bounds.getHeight. And what we would normally do is divide it by 2. But seeing as the actual string bounds, since the font size is same as the height of it, the string bounds height will be exactly the same as the bounds.height. So what we do, and you know, it doesn't take up the whole thing anyway. So what I'll do, we'll divide it by 2.5 preemptively. We might have to change that to 3 depending on how it looks, which we'll see. But if we set it to just 2, then the baseline would just be right at the bottom of the buttons box, and that would, and there would be too much free space above it, and that's why we do that. So finally, we can actually draw a string now, which will be the label X and Y. And that's how you draw a button. And the last method, we're gonna just add one more method, and it will be set colors. So you can just set all the colors. So your 3 colors, And all we do is, you know, foreground color equals foreground, background color equals background, and text color equals text. That's all we need for the set colors. And just in case, well, these, we haven't used those yet, which I don't know if we will or not, so I'll just put a suppress warning, since I don't like to see warnings on it. It just doesn't look good. Doesn't look very professional, does it? So what I was about to do is set the defaults for these colors. So the defaults won't be pretty, but that doesn't matter because we'll probably be setting it. So that can be black, and that can be gray, and the text color can just be black again. Pretty normal. So that is the whole. This is the GUI infrastructure that will be fine to start out with. We might need more, like we might make a GUI label or a GUI panel or something like that. But right now, all we really need is a GUI button. So just to test this, we're going to make an array list of GUI elements, and we're going to call it GUI. And of course, we have to import the array list and change this to GUI element since it doesn't have an S in it. And we're actually going to go to the imports and import everything in here since we will have to be using everything. And down here, a little bit out of the way, we're going to do public void initialize GUI. And we'll just call this method right here. So right before it goes into the loop, we'll say, you know, GUI equals new array list. And then we can actually make stuff like, let's say GUI button GB equals new GUI button. And of course this has a string, which is a label, and we'll just say test, and it will be framed, and it'll be located at, how about 25, 25, it'll be 200 wide, and 100 tall. Yeah, let's make this 300. What did I get wrong? Let's see. String boolean int. Oh. Silly me. So then we just do GUI.add GB. And last, but certainly not least, is that we remove this graphics testing. And we do for all the GUI elements in the GUI, why don't you go ahead and draw them. And let me just take the S off of this again. So confusing. So if we happen to run it right now, we can hope it works. Ta-da! A button. So as you can see, that it is a bit too close to the baseline. So what we can do is go back here and change this to 3. And hopefully it'll be a bit better. See? Well, I guess T is still kind of short. T is a short character. Let's just go with that. Like, there'll be more stuff up here if we do capitals. But, in fact, let's just change that to a capital T real quickly and see if I'm any more appeased. Yeah, close enough. So yeah, that's our button. Now, if it did have an action listener, we could actually, you know, press on this and things would happen. But aside from that, we also need to take the insets again. I did forget about that. And it is a pretty long episode. But as you can see, everything is working fine for the GUI. And, you know, next episode we'll actually create all, we'll account for the insets of the window, which we didn't do last episode. But we'll also actually set up all the buttons we will need to roll all the different types of dice. And then, if we have time after that, we can actually add the images, the die images that I made, which I am keeping in the diceroller.res, which stands for resources, which is where people normally, programmers normally keep all of their sounds and images and language files and everything that doesn't pertain to the actual code. So this has been me, Braliborn. This is episode 2 of the Dice Roller tutorial series, and I will see you next time.